and then tie it back to the real world. So to begin, what is a horn? Very simply put, a horn is a tube with a flare on the end. So something as simple as a beer bong becomes a horn. Other examples of horns are actual animal horns. This is a shofar. It's a Jewish ritual instrument. There's also German post horns and a lot of other things, and they can be made out of almost any material. Most recently, they've been developing carbon fiber trombones for very light and quick sliding. So the history. It's theorized that these horns, or they date back to 1500 BC, BCE, and they were used for communication during hunts and other religious purposes. And these horns, these simple horns that cannot change length, they're completely dependent on their overtone series. We're going to take a look at what the overtone series is in a little bit. But throughout time, musicians and instrument manufacturers found ways to strengthen the timbre, which is the characteristic sound of these horns, and give it the ability to play notes not in the overtone series. So what's the overtone series? The overtone series is what dictates the notes that can be played in a horn with a specific length. So for a horn that cannot change length, it can only play notes within its overtone series. So starting with the fundamental frequency, which is the lowest fundamental frequency that a horn can produce, see something like this. The frequencies that can be produced from there are just going to be multiples of that frequency. So going from there, 750, 1500, and continuing up. There's also a relationship between these notes when a note is played. So if I was to just play an F right now, everyone would probably say, yeah, that sounded like one note, right? Well, actually, all the overtones for that specific length layer on top of each other, and that's what creates the timbre for the horn. So if we say that this was the note I just produced, the F, there's actually a little bit of this frequency in there, a little bit of that, and we can see examples of this up here with the B flat and E flat. Instrument manufacturers got around to this problem by adding slides and valves and doing other things to horns so that they could change the length of it and allow it to play all notes and all harmonics. So there's two main horn shapes that come into play. That's conical and cylindrical. As you'd expect, a conical horn is shaped similar to a cone. It has a smaller diameter at the beginning and a larger diameter at the end. A cylindrical horn, on the other hand, is going to have the same diameter throughout the entirety of the horn. Now, that being said, this isn't universally true. If you look at them, you can tell that there's points where they do get a little bit wider. If you look at a trombone, it has a slide on top of another tube, so there's obviously going to be points where smaller diameter, bigger diameter, smaller diameter. But it's a good approximation, and it's the main way that we characterize these horns. The geometry of the horn has more to do with the timbre and the sound of it than its actual frequency. A cylindrical horn is going to have a more direct sound, and a conical horn is going to have a rounder, warmer tone. This is a cornet, which is a conical horn. It has a rounder sound, and a trumpet. Same exact lengths, they can produce the same frequencies, but they just have different sounds. So there's other horn shapes around. They don't really have to do with instrumental horns, so we're not going to look at them too much. But I thought it was interesting just to bring it up, and this figure gives a good idea of what those shapes might be. So we're going to look at some of the approximations now. And this is the important part of this. So the first approximation is that a cylindrical horn, we're actually going to call it a conical horn. It's going to be a cone. All horns are going to be cones. The difference is a cylindrical horn is going to have an apex at infinity. So the apex. The apex is the point on a cone where it all comes together. So if we imagine some infinite distance far away from this board, there's a point where it actually does come together. And we're so far away that the diameter just looks like it's constant, it's going to work out well for some of the formulas we're going to be looking at. The second assumption we're going to make is a constant flare rate assumption. Now, in reality, that's also not true. The flare of the bell is always, there's different flare rates as you move down the bell, but it becomes very, very complex and doesn't add too much. closed side being where the mouthpiece is, and the open side being where the bell is. And there's some important implications to that as well. The last approximation or assumption, it's more of an idea, is that as sound waves travel through the horn, they reach this bell, and only about 10% of them actually release out of the bell into our ears. The other 90% gets reflected back in due to the geometry and continues that process. So some terms I need to tell you about before we look at the formulas. Wave impedance or acoustic impedance, it's basically the ability for something to flow. So if something has a higher impedance, it's gonna have a harder time flowing. Lower impedance, easier time flowing. If the diameter is wider, you have a good time flowing. Smaller diameter, higher impedance. There's also pressure waves, and they can be spherical or planar. In an area of the horn that has a non-changing diameter, we're gonna see planar waves, and in the bells or in a conical horn where it's slightly increasing, we're gonna actually see spherical waves. We also have pitch and frequency, which is measured in hertz, and it's found dividing the speed of sound by its wavelength. Once again, cap bell reflectance. I should mention that the bell, with the higher harmonics of a horn, the bell actually tends to raise the higher harmonics in pitch just slightly. So that's another effect of a bell. And then we're actually gonna look at the embouchure and mouthpiece a little bit later, but they're the driving and amplifying force for the horn. So quick variables, I took the speed of sound to be at 343. Pressure is measured in pascals, that's our density of air. Cross-sectional area, variable S, and wavelength, just like frequency. Now we have mode here. Mode counts the number of nodes. What a node is an area of minimum pressure. If we have a pure standing wave, it's actually gonna have absolutely no pressure whatsoever. So as we increase our frequency, we're gonna have more and more nodes. And what the nodes actually tell us is the partial that the instrument's gonna be producing a sound at. There's also antinodes, which are exactly in between two nodes, and that's the area of the highest amount of pressure. So here's our formulas, and this is when it gets fun. So we have the general differential equation of a horn. It's a differential equation that relates the change in pressure to change in time and change in distance. And that's what's gonna give us all of our wave fronts and our pressure waves inside the horn. It's gonna help us approximate what that's gonna look like. We can see here that it depends on S, the shape or the cross-sectional area. So we need to come up with a shape equation or a cross-sectional area equation for the horn, and this is the one that fits best. So this is where our approximation of making the apex at infinity comes into play. For a conical horn, as X is going to be increasing, X naught stays constant. This is our apex X naught. X is going to increase as we move down the horn, and we're going to get a slightly larger and larger cross-sectional area. That makes sense. It's a cone. For a cylinder, if we put infinity right here at this X naught, this is going to quickly become zero, basically, and S is just going to equal S naught, no matter what value you put in for X. We also have an acoustic impedance formula, and that is the pressure divided by the speed of sound over or multiplied by the cross-sectional area. And something interesting about this is in an area where the horn bends, the cross-sectional area is not gonna change, but the pressure is gonna increase. So if the pressure increases and the cross-sectional area does not change, that means the acoustic impedance is gonna increase. So we're gonna have a slightly harder time flowing through these bends. So keep that in mind. Now the last two equations are what we're gonna take the most time on. These are two resonant frequency formulas. The first one is the resonant frequency formula for a closed open tube. And this is to second order. It puts into account the diameter. Typically, we only look at the length. And we're going to look at that in a second. We also have the resonant frequency of a cavity, which is also a Helmholtz resonator formula. What a Helmholtz resonator is basically a bottle. Like when you have a bottle filled up with liquid and you blow into it, and the pitch changes depending on how much volume it is, it's essentially Helmholtz resonator. So let's look at the mouthpiece. Now the mouthpiece acts as a Helmholtz resonator. Something really cool you can do with the mouthpiece, if you get all the specs of it, first to this bottom point, not the top in this situation. You can plug it all into that Helmholtz resonator formula and find a resonating frequency for your mouthpiece. So in theory, when I pop this mouthpiece, it should produce a tone of 206 hertz. Probably no one can tell me if that's 206, but I have a little strobe right here. So this is 207 hertz. It's actually slightly low, if anyone can hear. So this is actually a 240 hertz frequency. I don't know if you can tell, but that was almost the same exact frequency. So the formula was slightly off by about 20 hertz, 35 hertz, something like that. But it's still a good approximation. And that's the frequency that the horn's going to resonate at the best. Another thing mentioned was that the horn is the closed end of the open-closed tube. So if that's the case, we see from these figures that we have an anti-node on the closed end and a node on the closed end, or on the open end, sorry. What that means is we should expect very high pressures in the mouth, in the mouthpiece, practically constant pressures, and we'll see if that's actually what happens. Another effect of the mouthpiece is that it lowers the harmonics, which is opposite of the bell. The bell raises the harmonics, so the two of them actually work in tandem, and they fix the problems that the other one creates. Lastly is that the mouthpiece is the amplifier. In order for it to be an amplifier, we need a driving force. That's where the embouchure comes in. Now, the embouchure refers to the orientation of your mouth, everything that you're doing when you're creating a buzz. We can see from this diagram down here, each one of these are on the order of 1 millisecond, so this is 6 milliseconds total. We could estimate that the opening of this player's aperture is maybe 1 or 2 millimeters tall. And we also notice that this player uses more of his up lip, his top lip, than his bottom lip. It protrudes in a little bit more. And here we have a high-speed image of a GIF of someone playing. It's kind of dark. So let's look at some of this. So thanks to some work done by a guy named Booten and some of his colleagues, they took data on 10 trombone players and averaged it all out and found some data and some stats. So first thing to note, pressure in the mouth, constant pressure. That's what we would assume, that's what we said earlier. As it moves down to the lip, it's not so much constant pressure, but it's not as severe as down in the bore. Mouth, lips, bore. So we see that the pressure does change as it moves in. Another thing worth mentioning, down on this bottom graph, the upper lip and the lower lip, dark, black, and gray, they're actually not in phase here. What that means is that the peak of the upper lip occurs before the peak of the lower lip. And I would probably estimate they're out of phase by about pi over 4. And so that's really interesting, and this is something that occurred with all 10 of the players. But what it resulted in, as you can see this dotted line down here, this is the, oh, and I should mention, this is displacement versus time. So it's showing how things are changing with distance over time. The volume of lip that's actually in the mouthpiece is a steady sinusoidal wave, resulting from the two lips flapping back and forth. So wave front motions. This top image, this is what you would expect. This is what they would expect to see inside of a horn. And computer-generized models have estimated it to look like this. This is a 1,400 hertz signal inside of a trombone. And as we see, we have a high pressure, low pressure, HL, HL. It's kind of hard to see. There's also values down here for the pressure. But the main reason why I'm bringing this up is because you can tell that this is very, very complex. And this is just a computer-generated model. It's not actually what's going on. This is obviously not the shape of a bell, and all instruments are going to have different bells. So the wavefront motion inside of a horn is going to be very characteristic to the horn itself. All these complex patterns actually result from the reflectance of the bell pushing it back in and reflecting because of how complex this is at the higher frequencies, that's what makes it so squirrely for musicians to try to produce higher frequency notes. So I'm going to do a demo. I measured the specs on this beer bong, and I predicted that it should have a frequency of 153 hertz. So I'm going to give a tuner to John, and he's going to let me know how close I am to that frequency. with all the calculations, we find, I should mention that these are produced with a fundamental frequency of a B flat. The fundamental frequency of that is about 29.14 hertz. That's what we should expect to see. So when I plug the numbers into a tenor trombone, you can find a value of 31, 32 hertz. So not too far off. Similarly with the soprano trombone, which has exactly half the length of a tenor trombone, it has exactly double the fundamental frequency. And that also makes sense. So I tried to do it on my own. I tried to make a trombone with very similar specs to the best of my ability. And I'm gonna try to produce a tone on the fifth partial at that 153 hertz signal. And it actually does have a slide. It has the tone cannot be produced on a horn. A horn cannot sustain its own pedal tone. That means being said, I'm going to play a pedal B flat. So that was a pedal B flat. So I'm going to tell you what you just heard right there. You actually heard all of the upper harmonics and no pedal B flat. That's what I just produced right there. And the tone actually sounds a lot different from the rest of the horn. It has a much, much different timbre, and this is why. It has a whole lot of stacking of its upper harmonics, while a regular pitch does have stacking of harmonics, but it also has its own actual frequency and not too much in the upper range. And it's called a fictitious fundamental. So to conclude, I brought up a lot of different things and just touched on everything. So the next time you're at a musical experience or just listening to something in your headphones, try to think of one of the things I brought up here, and maybe it'll increase your musical experience. So I'd like to say thanks to everyone for coming, all the students for being here with me through the 4 years, all the physics faculty for getting me to where I am. I'd like to give special thanks to Joe and Mr. Brown for recruiting me 4 years ago, and all the music